Welcome to our talk, Reaching Millions of Goals with Goal Effect. Just to start out, we're just going to introduce ourselves, the company we work for, preworked.org, Goal Effect, and the main project that we've been working on and that we're going to be talking about, Springster.
So I'm Codie. Please don't make the mistake of calling me Codie the Coder. I've been working for preworked for just over 4 years. And as you can see, I really need a new Twitter handle.
Right. And I'm Jamie. I'm a site reliability engineer at preworked. And I guess I build most of the software that Codie software runs on top of. So just to talk a little bit about preworked, we're a nonprofit founded back in 2007. And we aim to use mobile technology to solve some of the world's largest social problems. And the way we do that is we leverage open source technology, and we aim to reach people who may not have a computer or the latest smartphones, and we give them access to information and services, particularly around healthcare.
And Goal Effect is an organization that we partner with in the UK. It was set up by the Nike Foundation in 2008 with the mission of providing girls globally access to information via youth brands and mobile platforms to empower their lives and drive change. One of these brands is Springster, which was previously known as GEM, Goal Effect Mobile, was born in 2014. Springster is a global mobile-first website which celebrates the diverse, inspirational, and convention-defying experience of girls all around the world. We have sites in 67 countries in around 16 different languages, and so far we've managed to reach 16 million users. Most users access the site through a feature phone, like the image on your right, but we also have a smartphone version, like the image on the left. And so we want to take you through the journey of how we managed to scale to that many sites. And we're going to speak about the journey and really emphasize that there was no silver bullet or aha moment. It was just small things that allowed us to be able to get where we are at now. And so one of the things that we've built is the Molo platform. Molo is an open source set of tools that allows us to publish Mobi sites. We had a lot of sites running on a platform called Universal Core, but Molo came from a need to be able to get more user-generated content and allow the users to interact with the sites in a more meaningful way. And so it offers a lot of community features like profiles, comments, polls, surveys, tips, and reaction questions. Essentially, Molo is a skeleton that allows a company to add a skin or CSS, choose which plugins they want, and create their own content in a language that they would like. Also, Molo is built on a CMS called Wagtail, which is built on top of Django. So some of the sites that we've put out there is UNICEF's Internet of Good Things, the UNFPA's TuneMe, and Baby Center. And if you look at them closely, you can kind of see that they all follow the same pattern. You've got the logo on the left there, and you've got some sort of banner below that, and then sections with articles underneath that. And so the year is 2014. Facebook launches Free Basics, which essentially is an incubator with 100 new sites that is free for users to access. And all of these sites were built with Molo. And so what that means is you needed a site for each country that Free Basics launched in, and all of those needed their own URL and their own localization. And so we were able to simultaneously launch in different countries, but a lot of different countries.
And so we partnered with Facebook for their Free Basics launch. And what they would do is they would basically tell us that they had these upcoming priority countries each month. And this would be a batch of, say, like 10, 20 countries. And they wouldn't necessarily launch in all of those countries when they said. It would just kind of that was their target. But they expected us to keep up with this target ahead of time. So it was really important we were able to keep up. And within the space of 6 months or even less, we kind of went from running in like 3 countries to suddenly running in about 70 or more countries. So how did we do this? At the time, kind of the simplest and fastest way was really by just kind of making lots of copies of these different sites. Each country was meant to have its own URL and custom content. So we kind of just scaled by replicating and then customizing each site. So I'm just going to go over kind of this is how we used to do things back in the day when we didn't need to run lots of sites. So this looks very if you run something like Django, this is probably quite familiar to you. You basically have a web server like Nginx, then you have your site, and then you have some database. And you kind of just chuck this on a VM, and that's the simplest solution. And this is very simple, not very fancy, but it kind of made sense because of the way we did things back then. Generally, a project would just have a VM, and the project would have a certain lifetime based on how long it was funded for. And then once you were done, you just shut down the VM for that particular project. But obviously, this has shortcomings. If the host goes down, goodbye site. It's not particularly scalable, things like that. So when you run more of these, the most obvious thing to do is just use some kind of automation or configuration management and just punch out more of these VMs, which you can do pretty consistently. But obviously, a lot of the same issues. If a VM goes down, lose the site, you have a lot more to manage. You have, like, now I've got 4 databases. And these are all just single points of failure. You're also probably not making very efficient use of resources because you maybe don't need an entire VM just for one site. So the next thing we tried was really to work on that problem of resource utilization, just basically put more sites on a single VM and then route between them using Nginx. And the way we did this is just put more sites and then use some kind of process supervisor to keep track of all of those. Then we also broke out the database just so that can be separately managed and you can add a replica for failover and stuff like that. This obviously still has some serious problems. How do you choose which sites to put on which servers? What if one site gets a whole lot of traffic and it kind of impacts the performance of the others? These are very kind of common problems. And now suddenly, if a VM goes down, you maybe lose 10 sites, which is worse. We kind of started looking at container and container orchestration around 2015, and I did a bit of a talk on this at ScaleConf 2016. We hoped to kind of automate away a lot of these problems using container orchestration. We hoped to, by having a container orchestrator and an automated system to schedule containers onto hosts, we would have easy and replicable deployments. We could define how much resources each container would get, and then a computer could decide where to run sites rather than us, which we were not very good at. And also, we'd have systems like automated failover or self-healing when a node goes down. So a very sort of quick crash course on how one of these things works. Generally, you have a set of kind of master or controller nodes. This kind of pink-purple logo is for Mesosphere DCOS, which we happen to use. But these principles are pretty much identical for something like Kubernetes. Then you have this pool of nodes or worker nodes that run the actual containers. And when you want to scale up, you can kind of just add more VMs to this pool of workers. You have an ingress or load balancer, and that's kind of your gateway between the internet and the containers. And then generally, you kind of run your stateful services outside of this, although it is possible also to run those as containers. So just to reiterate, control plane controls everything that goes on within this pool of worker nodes. Your containers run on the worker nodes. The control plane kind of automates the placement of the containers. And then the load balancer routes traffic into those containers. And finally, the stateful services, which you need databases and stuff like that. So my earlier diagram of what a monocyte is and how it is deployed was a little bit simplified. We actually also use Celery for long-running tasks and scheduled tasks. Kind of ironically, yesterday's talk also mentioned Celery and the problems with it. And while the speaker was talking about Celery, some of our engineers were trying to fix something with Celery. So basically the way that works is a monocyte will kind of put some work task onto a message broker like RabbitMQ, and then Celery will kind of process through that work at a later time. So how does this map onto the container infrastructure? It's reasonably straightforward. We'd have a container for the site itself and then a couple of containers for Celery. Those would connect up to the stateful services much the same way they did. When a request comes in from a user, the ingress kind of just routes to the correct container based on the domain or URL. And when you want to add more of these things, it's pretty straightforward. You just configure more of them, and the ingress will route based on the domain. And this worked pretty well. Like, we could run lots of these containers, lots of these sites. We had, you know, we made much more efficient use of our resources. Things failed over automatically. All that was kind of solved. So around kind of late 2016, early 2017, we kind of hit the peak containers, or the largest cluster we had, which was running on Hetzner in Johannesburg, and this was about 30 worker nodes running about 900 containers. And this wasn't all just Springstone Molo specifically, it was kind of shared between all our services, but it was predominantly this large, large number of sites we needed to run. And this was all managed by a team of four SREs. But obviously, this is still quite not ideal, and we were running just a lot more apps and containers than we really needed to. While we could run these things really quickly and easily, which was great, we were running these sites as like mostly completely separate services, while there are lots of similarities between them.
This actually meant that there was a big maintenance overhead for content managers. If they wanted to upload an article, they would have to do it 67 times. If they made a mistake in that article, they would have to rectify it 67 times. And that number increases significantly if you have a site in more than one language. And so just to give you some context, what we started off with was a Django application like this. We had the Wagtail CMS. And inside the CMS, we had a site URL that interacted with a set of content, and it had a front end attached to that. We had 67 of these. And so what we realized is that a lot of these, most of these sites had the same content and could actually be grouped via language. And so we implemented what we called a merge CMS or a multi-site CMS, where we grouped all of the Spanish-speaking countries together in one CMS and all of the French-speaking countries together. We went from 67 applications to 15, but we still had 67 different sets of content. So within one CMS, we had different URLs pointing to different sets of content. This did make it easier for the content managers because you were able to copy and paste within the same CMS, but it was still a little bit of a pain. And so what we did next was we were able to point multiple sites to one set of content since they were all the same. And so the benefits of that were obviously you're hosting much less sites. There's cost efficiencies. Our content team is in the UK and gets paid with pounds. And so the less time they spent on it, the more money they saved. There were less content errors. There was less frustration from content managers. And we were also able to manage user expectation. When you want to publish an article at the same time every week, and you make one mistake with that, it throws out your whole schedule, and users don't really know what to expect.
Okay, so the next thing we wanted to do was kind of consolidate all the work we had been doing. And we did this through a project we called Core Infrastructure. So GirlEffect wanted to have one common platform for all their projects, whether that was a project that we as breakout.org built or somebody else they worked with. But they contracted us to build out a new container, specialized container infrastructure based on AWS. Obviously, I don't really need to convince too many people about the benefits of being on AWS in the cloud, but we didn't really need to host things in Johannesburg anymore. So we built out the shared container infrastructure, and we also built a centralized data and auth service, which kind of was part of their work towards complying with GDPR. So moving to AWS, this was made a lot easier by the fact that we had kind of already containerized a lot of our work. So moving containers is quite easy. Probably the harder part is just transferring the contents of databases between the two data centers. We also adopted a new system for continuous deployment of containers called Spinnaker, which I'll talk a little bit on the next slide. And we started making just heavier use of AWS services, things like the obvious candidates like RDS for databases. But we're also starting to look at some of their newer sort of emerging services like Lex, which may allow us to build new services featuring things like text-to-speech. We're also able to provide better guarantees in terms of reliability. You know, AWS provides multiple availability zones, which is not really something you get with the local hosting providers. So I'm going to talk a little bit about Spinnaker. And we quite like this tool for continuous deployment. If you haven't looked at it, check it out. It's very flexible, so it allows you to kind of use a lot of the existing services that you might be using. And in our case, because so much of what we do is open source, we kind of use whatever the best free open source tool is, whether that's GitHub or Docker Hub or Travis CI. And those can integrate with Spinnaker, and then we're able to deploy our containers to a container platform in a pretty automated way.
And I particularly like Spinnaker because before we were using something that we built called Mission Control, and if we wanted to deploy it to production, we had to individually deploy all 67 sites, and now I can just press a button.
Yeah, so in some ways it almost solved the problem of like running too many containers, but obviously it still made sense to try and reduce those number of containers. And we also had, you know, new things like automated deployments to a staging environment. Another thing we've kind of been doing over the years is trying to have a lot of commonality between the different Docker images we build. So for something that's kind of Django-based, there's quite a lot of kind of best practices you need to get right when you're deploying a site built with Django. So if you're unfamiliar with building Docker images, basically the way you do it is you start with an existing image and you kind of add extra things on top of that, and as you build your images, they become more specialized to what you need. So starting at the kind of bottom of the stack, we'd use the Python image from upstream, from the official images source. And then the SRE team, my team, would basically add more sort of lower level things, almost like sysadmin-y features, things like getting best practices for the web server configuration or like a non-root user, things like that. And then finally on top of that, developers only really had to worry about their source code and the actual app. So we had quite a lot of commonality in the images we use, and pretty much everything we deploy that is based on Django uses this Django Bootstrap image. There's a link, I did a talk at PyCon about this as well.
So now that we've scaled to this degree, we now need to look at how we scale going forward. Back when GirlEffect started out, girls had access to information via the community, their school, their religious institutions, like a church, for example, a newspaper, magazine, television, radio. whereas right now, they have a lot of information shouting at them through Google, blogs, websites, Facebook, social media, you name it. Girls have more access to more information more often and faster before. And so what we are needing to do is, instead of expecting the users to find us at our website, we are needing to go find them through multiple channels. We have a large quantity of high-quality content in our CMS, but we need to re-architect our system to deliver content on more than just a mobile site. Essentially, we want swappable front ends for all different channels that we need, which is obviously a headless CMS, where we'd have one application that would where all the content would live, and we'd be able to use that, push that content to any channel, whether it's WhatsApp, a web app, or something like iOS, for example.
One of the things we've been doing more recently is kind of reassessing our use of open source software. Everything that breakout.org does is open source eventually, and we really wouldn't be the same organization or able to do the things we do without open source. I think that same is true for a lot of companies. But there is this need to kind of keep up with what's happening in the open source community. And sometimes you have to kind of walk this fine line and balance kind of writing your own custom differentiated code that solves a very specific problem, or leveraging maybe some more general tools within the open source ecosystem.
And something else that we've been learning is that back when Molo started and we built it on top of Wagtail, Wagtail didn't give us all the, they didn't meet all of our requirements. And so we ended up customizing it a lot within Molo. But since then, Wagtail has actually built a lot of those features within the CMS itself. And so now we're having to look at getting rid of our features and using theirs. But going forward, also asking ourselves the question, does it make sense to build it in Molo, or does it make sense to build it in Wagtail?
And kind of somewhat similarly on the infrastructure and things, we've been using this Mesos platform. And while I'm sure Mesosphere is able to provide a good service to their larger enterprise customers, we're just a small nonprofit, and we rely more on open source software. And I think largely in the past few years, Kubernetes has just gained kind of an unbelievable amount of traction within the open source community. And while Mesosphere and U2S still works very well for us, we're having to build little bits of infrastructure to kind of extend it in certain ways. And those things kind of already exist in Kubernetes open source space. So we're having to kind of revisit which container orchestration system we're using. And then just to conclude and kind of summarize some of the lessons we've learned. A lot of these things are, I think, in a way, kind of common sense and almost quite obvious, but I think they're really reflected in the kind of journey we've been through. So first of all, really kind of want to echo some of what the first talk of yesterday talked about, that you know, scaling kind of happens in these different and maybe unexpected and unpredictable ways. I think we often talk about scaling purely in terms of operating at scale or performance or vertical versus horizontal scaling, but sometimes it's just suddenly you need to launch you know, like 20 customized sites in 20 new countries like next month, and how are you going to do that? And so I think flexibility and the ability to adapt to business requirements is really important. And we think that kind of chasing off these things and being able to deliver a product to your user is kind of the most important thing, really. And it's a reasonable idea to kind of take an incremental approach to consolidating and optimizing what you've done after that. And then finally, just kind of like I talked about, reflecting on building your own system versus using what's available in the open source ecosystem.
So having to scale that quickly came with a lot of challenges, a lot of frustration, But being a nonprofit, we're lucky enough to be able to impact girls all around the world. And so we're just going to show you a quick video of what that looks like.
Aga, tapos nagre-ready po para sa school. Pagkarating ko po, kakain po muna ako, tapos maglalaba po ko ng uniform ko. Tapos yun po, magsa-cellphone, then matutulog. Ito po yung Springster, gamit po yung pre-basics. Kung wala ka pong alam kung paano mamuhay bilang babae, kung ano po ba yung mga dapat na action na gagawin mo pag nasa panganib ka, then, pagka paano po yung sa mga bagay na hindi mo po alam, narin po pagka first time na nagkaroon po ng menstruation, hindi mo po alam kung paano gagawin. Kasi yung pag-iipon po din. Hanggang sa nakahiligan ko na po magbasa. Tuwing gabi po, mga at least 1 hour po, nagbabasa po ako dun. At po talaga ako sa Springster kasi simula po nung nalaman ko po yung app na yun, parang yung mga bagay na nabigulan pa po ako, yung mga bagay na hindi ko pa po answer na malaman yun, mas may pa-improve po yung sarili ko. Manuuna po makatapos ko ng pag-aaral.
Yeah, thanks.
Any questions down the front?
Hi, Chelsea from Thought Express. Firstly, thank you for the talk. I think what you guys are doing is so important, and providing this kind of information and accurate information, especially when it comes to childbirth and pregnancy, I think what you guys are doing is really impressive. Just a question about when you guys were going through this huge expansion and deploying into multiple countries, did you experience any pushback about the content? Because obviously you're dealing with different religions, different cultures, especially on these kind of topics, everyone has very different belief systems. So how did you handle that?
So even though a lot of the sites had the same content, Girl Effect had 4 countries that had in-country content teams that would build out content for those specific countries. Those were Nigeria, Philippines, Indonesia, and South Africa. We found that there were many differences, like the girl in South Africa has to grow up a lot quicker than a girl in Indonesia, for example. And the advice that we would give to a girl in South Africa about maybe coming out as homosexual, we can't exactly give that same advice to somebody in Indonesia where that's illegal. And so for those 4 countries, they have local teams that provide content. And we also, all of those content teams also reply to every single comment on that site.
Hi. Just have a quick question. After you have migrated to AWS, how did the cost of running all of those services look? If it was too high, what were some of the things you did to optimize your cost?
So optimizing the cost, obviously, one of the things we talked about was just reducing the number of sites. I think it's still kind of ultimately cheaper to be running in the cloud than managing your own hosts in a data center in South Africa. There wasn't like a specific service or site that was kind of using too much resources and was too expensive. We have been doing some work recently around optimizing costs in AWS in terms of
just like picking the latest instance types that offer the best value for money, reserved instances, stuff like that.
Okay, first of all, that's very cool. Congratulations. It's a tremendous feat to be able to implement that many integrations in such a small amount of time. Did you find any difficulties with, obviously you have, it's based on free base internet, which means it's going through the telcos. What kind of integration pains and difficulties did you guys run into? And question number two is, what is your lead time now between if you decide to launch in any country today?
I think in terms of integration, that was mostly handled by Facebook themselves. Everything kind of goes through their servers first. So, yeah.
When it comes to launching a new site, if it's a Springster site, we can launch a new site from the technical side in a matter of 1 or 2 days. But obviously they would need to load the content, which takes longer, but we'd be able to replicate that site very quickly.
Hi, just a question about like your code. I see you guys, well, you use a lot of open source technologies and everything. Do you have, is your code base also open source so that other people can also contribute to it? Because it's kind of a great project, so.
Sure, yeah, Molo is completely open source. Like literally everything is open source that we do other than like our Puppet code basically is the only thing that's not open source. Yeah, you can find it all on GitHub, I should probably put a link, but you can search for it.
Do you take contributions?
Yeah, we kind of do where we can. We are quite a small organization, and we're, I guess, often driven by what we have funding for. But we do for a lot of things.
Yeah, thanks for the talk. I've got a question about this idea of your sort of third-party content integrator. So you mentioned that to get the reach you needed, you had to think about things like WhatsApp and Facebook. So how do you balance that against potentially losing your message? I mean, we look at a lot of the way media run on things like Facebook. You might end up in a channel you don't want to be, alongside context and content you don't want to be, whereas if you've got your own platform, you can very carefully curate that. So how do you balance those two with these kind of media?
Publishing content on a platform that we don't control, like Facebook, how do we balance being in charge of our own content versus reaching people?
That's a difficult question.
I think, yeah, it's definitely something we've been thinking about, and Girl Effect as well has been thinking about, and they are, I think, keen to do quite a lot of content on Facebook itself, but yeah, we obviously kind of focus on these mobile sites. We have quite a lot of experience using WhatsApp through some of our other services, not Springster specifically, so we feel like we're pretty good at those platforms, but yeah, it is kind of a constant struggle.
Yeah, it is also something that we're still figuring out, because a lot of the content is very sensitive. Having that content on Facebook, users might not want to comment or say what they've been through, whereas right now on Molo, we allow them to do that anonymously. So that's something we're trying to figure out, is how do we push all the content to those channels, but still keep psychological safety for our users.
Good morning. Thank you so much for the talk, and congratulations again. I just wanted to find out in terms of when you guys are deploying a certain change or feature, seeing that you're supporting so many different platforms and so many different products, Do you have a fully fledged automation framework that handles that, or are you testing all of your different products in isolation? Thank you.
I guess one of the things you can say is that we do still use like a staging environment, despite the talk yesterday. We generally, when we do have a QA team that does things like check the sites, we do have continuous integration and deployment systems for a lot of our Docker stuff, like Docker images are built automatically from the latest version of Molo, things like that. Like I mentioned, Spinnaker, automatic deployment to staging. There are a bunch of fancy things you can do with Spinnaker, which we haven't got into yet. Like, you can configure a pipeline that, after deploying to QA, sends an email to your QA team to say, hey, this is the site, or sets up the test. So it's very flexible. I think, do you want to talk about your?
And we also have automated tests running in production that QA has set up, and they will sort of alert us if something is wrong. And we do that for some of the important features like logging in and being able to comment, changing your password, for example.